Grace and peace to you from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. We'll give our attention again to the Apostle Paul's words in Romans chapter 10. Moses writes this about the righteousness that is by the law. The person who does these things will live by them. But the righteousness that is by faith says, "Do not say in your heart, 'Who will ascend into heaven?' that is, to bring Christ down. Or, 'Who will ascend into the deep?' that is, to bring Christ up from the dead. But what does it say? 'The word is near you. It is in your mouth and in your heart.' That is the message concerning faith that we proclaim. If you declare with your mouth, 'Jesus is Lord,' and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For it is with your heart that you believe and are justified, and it is with your mouth that you profess your faith and are saved. As Scripture says, 'Anyone who believes in him will never be put to shame.' For there is no difference between Jew and Gentile. The same Lord is Lord of all, and richly blesses all who call on him. For everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved." This is the word of our Lord. Dear brothers and sisters, Jesus came to the region of Caesarea Philippi, and he asked his disciples what people were saying about him. And the list that they gave was pretty impressive. John the Baptist, Jeremiah, Elijah, none of those guys were slouches. They were all firebrand prophets who stood up to the establishment and didn't back down from declaring, "This is what the Lord says." But as impressed as all those people were by Jesus, they all fell short in what they thought. Peter was blessed to know it. "You are the Messiah, the Son of the living God." Jesus does way more than to tell people where to find salvation. Jesus' message is, "I am salvation." And that truth is the rock on which God's church, God's people, is built. The confession that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God. He's not just one of God's great prophets. He's the Christ, the Lord. In Romans chapter 10, the Apostle Paul says essentially the same thing as Peter said in Matthew chapter 16. That if you declare with your mouth, "Jesus is Lord," and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. And the Christian hears that and responds, "Amen. In Christ alone my hope is found." But for someone who doesn't believe in Jesus, that's an insult. That's maybe even fighting words. To say that Jesus is one of God's great prophets is one thing. But to say that Jesus is the world's only hope, the only God and Savior, that is raising Jesus to the ultimate level. So someone objects. "Well, it doesn't matter what God you worship as long as you believe," but no. Someone else objects, "Well, what really makes the difference is whether you're a good person." But no. But this really isn't the time to be dwelling on what everybody else thinks about Jesus. The predominant pronoun in these verses is "you." And not all y'all plural. Just you. The confession of your own mouth, the faith in your own heart, and where Jesus fits into people who have fallen through the cracks of society. So some examples, drug addicts, drug dealers, prostitutes, gangsters, dirty cops, victims of abuse, perpetrators of abuse, the mentally ill on the streets. This guy, he sits down with them, and he turns on his microphone, and he lets them tell their story. And these are the kind of people that normally aren't listened to. Maybe because our society finds it easier to pretend that those kind of people really aren't people. Maybe because it's more comfortable for our society to make assumptions about how they got where they are. Maybe because our society has a collective fear that if we listen to them, we'll discover that we're really not so different from them. And each person's interview is unique, but all their stories, they still kind of rhyme. There's a lot of darkness and hopelessness, not many happy endings. Mostly stuff like, this is what I did to myself, or this is what was done to me, and I've tried to get out of it, but I can't. So, it is what it is. And other thing, there's so much crying. Tears, just straight from the heart, and the people say in the interview, I'm sorry that I'm crying so much and messing up your interview. But they're not really messing up the interview. They're just giving us more insight into their pain. And here's why I bring this up. For one, those people that he interviews, I think of them as the 21st century version of the tax collectors and the prostitutes of Jesus' day. But by and large, the tax collectors and the prostitutes, they were on the rock bottom of hopelessness and darkness. And when you're there at the bottom, that's when you best understand what it means to need a savior. And Jesus never drove them away. And why bring it up? Number two, when we listen to stories of people like that, I think we find that it's kind of like looking in the mirror. You see a little bit, at least a little bit of us. Maybe not what we look like on the surface, because we put those things underneath the surface. Our fears and our sins and our shame and our self-destruction. We might even block those things from ourselves. Blocking it out of our consciousness because we're afraid that if we think about those things, that despair will just overwhelm us. But it's there that when we are in those depths, when we're at the bottom, that phrase is sweetest. Jesus is Lord. Let's focus on that phrase in its context in Romans chapter 10. So it never hurts to follow along in the service folder. It's on page 9. The Apostle Paul, he writes about two kinds of righteousness. And for righteousness, picture righteousness as coming up out of that pit and being right before God. So the first kind of righteousness is in verse 5. The righteousness that is by the law. So this type of righteousness is redeeming yourself by climbing out of your own pit and demonstrating to God that you are good enough for him.
This is self-redemption. But once we get past verse 5, the righteousness that is by the law, that disappears. It doesn't come up again because it is impossible for us to achieve. You know what happens to the pit? It only gets deeper if we go that way. Everything after verse 5, the righteousness that is by faith. This righteousness isn't the result of doing. This righteousness is the result of receiving. So verse 6, the righteousness that is by faith says, do not say in your heart, who will ascend into heaven, that is to bring Christ down, or who will ascend into the deep, that is to bring Christ up from the dead. To put faces on those words, picture it like this. A man or a woman or a boy or a girl stewing at the bottom of their own pit, thinking to themselves, now, what am I going to do to get Christ to save me? Do you see how ridiculous that thinking is? That's trying to turn God's work into your work. Who will ascend into heaven to bring Christ down? He already came down to save them. It's called Christmas. Who will ascend into the deep to bring Christ up from the dead? He already did that too. It's called Easter. Did these people forget what Jesus did to save them? Or do they think that he didn't do it well enough the first time and he needs their help to do it again, this time to do it right? But isn't that the way we think? Not that anyone in here would dream of kicking Jesus out to the curb and saying to themselves, Jesus isn't enough to save me. I've got to do it on my own. But the thinking that we've got to help him, that comes pretty easily to us. If I can just keep my urges under control. If I can just go a week without falling into the same sin all over again. If I can just make my faith a little bit stronger. And it feels like this. You can tell me after church if you don't agree. That it's like Jesus has dropped you just a few feet short of the finish line. But the finish line, whatever you do, it's always still another couple feet away. But what you need for righteousness, the Apostle Paul says, is not out of reach. So we're still going through verse by verse. Verse 8. It's near you. It is in your mouth and in your heart. What you need is already yours. And what is the it that you need? If you're following along, you know what it is. It's the word. Not word as in a secret that only a few can know, or word in the sense of a command that only the strong can obey, not word in the sense of a theorem that only the intelligent can understand. That word that's already yours, it's a promise. It's Jesus is Lord. And not Jesus is Lord in the sense of master. Though I fear that word Lord is commonly understood with that connotation in many Christian circles. Jesus is Lord in the all capital letters sense of the Old Testament. All capital letters, Lord. But the Lord that proclaimed his name as he passed in front of Moses in the first reading, who does not leave the guilty unpunished, but at the same time,
forgives wickedness, rebellion, and sin. And the Lord accomplished that by his death on the cross when he took the place under his own wrath for punishment and declared the entire world forgiven as a result. That Jesus is Lord is another way of saying that Jesus is the only God and Savior. In Christ alone, my hope is found. And that word, that promise is near you. It's in your mouth and in your heart. Not on the other side of the finish line. Not just out of reach, always a day away. It's already yours. And it's everything. Verse 9. If you declare with your mouth, Jesus is Lord, and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. And just in case that sounds like all you have to do, print and at the fine print at the bottom of an offer that's too good to be true, as if, well, there are some words that you need to say in order to seal the deal and cross the finish line. In case it sounds that way to you, let's think again about those people in the podcast interviews. The tax collectors and the prostitutes of the 21st century who've hit the rock bottom of darkness and hopelessness, who just think to themselves, it is what it is. I'm in too deep and I can't climb up. Or if you have trouble picturing somebody like that, just imagine how your own story rhymes with theirs more than you would care to admit. And what does God give you? A word. Not a word in your mouth and in your heart in the sense that it's always been there. But it's in your mouth and in your heart because someone told you. Jesus is Lord, as in Jesus is Savior. He paid for your sin. He gave you his righteousness. It's not by what you do, it's by what he did, and it's done. And when Jesus comes again to make all things right, every bit of shame and guilt and hurt, even if you feel like you're just a big sack of regret, will be gone forever, and you will never again be anything less than righteous. You will be saved, to use Paul's words. Anyone who believes in him will never be put to shame. When you're at rock bottom, and God sends someone to you with that word, Jesus is Lord, and God turns on the light bulb of faith in your heart, there's nothing for you to add to what Jesus has done. So all you can think of doing is saying back to God what God has already said to you. Yes. Jesus is Lord. Jesus is my Savior. You see, that's not adding to what God has done. That's simply agreeing that God has done it. To say with your mouth, Jesus is Lord is simply to echo back to God what God has already promised to you. So sorry, miracle. You're not going to be doing anything for God this morning when Pastor Lindemann reads the passage and you confess with your mouth, Jesus is Lord. You're simply doing what all of us do every Sunday in the Confession of Sins and the Apostles' Creed, repeating back to God what God has already said to you. And to object and say, well, what really matters is that you're a good person. That's to ignore the pit that we're in outside of Jesus. Whenever you try to climb out, the same thing happens. The pit only gets deeper. And to object that it makes no difference what you believe or what you call your God as long as you believe, that's to ignore the fact that there is only one who came down from heaven. There's only one who died on the cross and rose from the dead. And by saying that, it doesn't matter who you believe in as long as you believe. You see what that's doing to faith? It's making faith into the work that earns us something before God instead of the thing that holds on to God's promise of what he's done for us. There's only one Jesus, the Son of the living God. And remember how I pointed out earlier that the predominating pronoun in this section is you. The faith in your heart, the profession from your mouth. But since we're going through this verse by verse, I also need to point out that there is a big shift in verse 11. Shift from you to all. Anyone who believes in him will never be put to shame. Everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. No matter how deep their pit, there's a word, a promise of God for them. Jesus is Savior. And Jesus will never drive them away. There's just a word that they need to hear. And you know what? It's in your heart and in your mouth because God put it there by someone else for you to say to them, Jesus is Savior. In Christ alone, your hope is found.